Hello, Patrick Walchuk here with the Agent in Ottawa team, and this is a video about the changes in the Ontario government legislation in terms of how real estate agents are now legislated to interact with each other and with you, the consumer. Now, this particular video is going to deal with buyers, and we also have done a video which is dealing with sellers. So right off the top, this is called TRESA, the Trust in Real Estate Act 2002. Correct, 2002, because it replaces or amends the previous act, which is called REBA, the Real Estate and Business Brokers Act of 2002. So the first thing that you need to know, that you as a buyer, if you contact a real estate agent and you want to go see a property, they're going to email you a document. It's a 13-page document produced by the Real Estate Council of Ontario, and it explains some of the things I'm going to discuss with you in terms of how you're going to be represented. And what it looks like is this, Trust in Real Estate Act, okay? So you sign it and it's returned to the agent that you're going to be seeing the property with. So that's number one. Number two, under TRESA, you are either going to be a client or you're going to be what's called an SRP, a self-represented party. So let's talk about what it means to be a client, number one. So first of all, you sign some papers, and one of them is a contract called the Buyer Representation Agreement. And when you do that, you then have the undivided loyalty of the real estate agent. He has a fiduciary duty to protect your best interests, in other words. Disclosure. They have to disclose everything that they know about a property, about the seller, the seller's motivation, anything to do with the property, defects, that kind of thing. That has to be disclosed to you. Confidentiality, anything that you and your realtor discuss, that remains between you and your realtor. Whether it's the price you want to pay for the property, the terms and conditions you want to put in there, your motivations, whatever it is. And number four, they can appraise the property, typically called a CMA, comparative market analysis, and provide you with a pricing strategy on the property. So for example, if a house is listed at $800,000, I do an appraisal on the property and it only comes in at $750,000. I say, hey, this property is significantly overpriced. So I'm going to recommend that we start our negotiations at $735,000. That's a pricing strategy that we're going to start at. And then we'll talk about what kind of strategy we're going to use in order to be able to get the property at or below fair market value for you. So that's basically how a client relationship works. And that's basically how it worked before. Okay. Now, what's different is that there's really no semi-efforts here in terms of what it used to be, and you could deal with an agent and you would be called a customer. I won't get into it. It was kind of silly, but it was the law for about 20 years. So anyhow, now you're either a client or an SRP. So as a self-represented party, let's talk about what that means to you. So you go see a property with an agent. You don't want to work with an agent. And so what that means is that there is no confidentiality, no services that that agent can provide you. They can't provide you with any opinions, no advice. Any service that I offer you is for the benefit of my seller. The only reason I'd be showing you the property is because you might put an offer in on it, which would be a benefit to my seller, okay? Now, anything that you tell me, I have to disclose that to the seller. So if you talk to me about your motivation, oh geez, I just moved to the city, I gotta buy a property in the next week. I have to tell that to the seller. I must disclose how much money you're willing to pay to my seller client if you tell me that. I have to disclose your preferred terms and conditions. I can't do an appraisal on the property, so you don't know its true market value. So that $800,000 property, for all you know, it might be really well priced. I can't advise you on pricing. I can perform the action of preparing some basic things in an offer for you, but I can add nothing to the offer that uses my skill, experience, or knowledge. So let me give you an example. I show you a property, you say, I don't want to deal with a real estate agent. I don't want to be married to one of you people. So I want you to prepare an offer for me. Well, I can put in your name, the buyer, the seller's name, you know, the lot size is 50 by 100 feet deep, and let's say the legal description. After that, you're on your own. So I can't recommend an irrevocable time to you. And if you're a first-time buyer, you probably think, what's an irrevocable time? Well, I can't help you with that. A price. You might say, well, what price should I go in at? Hey, you're a self-represented party. Can't help you with that. Sorry. You say, what title search date? Or I say, okay, what title search date do you want me to put in the offer for you? And they say, I don't know. What's a good one? I can't tell you, because that's using my experience and my knowledge to be able to assist you. And I can't do that. It is illegal. What clauses do you want to use? Such as, do you want to have a walkthrough prior to closing of the property? Do you need a survey? How do you ask for a survey? Are you aware of a vacant unit tax declaration that should appear in an offer? Are you aware of the City of Ottawa's green loan, in which there can be a loan against the property for up to $125,000? That might be a really nasty surprise the day that you take possession of that property. What if your bank appraiser needs to access the property, but you haven't made a provision for that in your offer and they can't get in? You're going to be SOL. Now, what conditions do you want to insert to best protect your interests? Do you even know the difference between a condition and a regular clause? How long is the condition for? What happens to your deposit? Let's say you put down a $20,000 deposit. What happens to your deposit if you don't meet your conditions? You want to have a successful building inspection. The inspection falls through. Does the seller get to keep your $20,000? Maybe. Maybe. If you didn't do things properly, do you know what to do? I can't even recommend other professionals to you. Say, geez, can you recommend a lawyer to you because you don't have one, an appraiser, a building inspector, that kind of thing. That's using my experience, my knowledge to provide advice to you, and I cannot do that. You are on your own. And it's very high risk. So I would strongly, strongly advise you to call a lawyer and have a lawyer help you prepare an offer. However, there's always a but, right? So here's the but. The lawyer prepares an offer, you're going to have to pay them for it, right? You don't have to pay an agent if you're working with an agent. Now, a lawyer can't do an appraisal on the property. They can't say, hey, that $800,000 property is only worth $750,000. What do they know? They don't belong to the Ottawa Real Estate Board. They don't do appraisals. That's not their business. So you still don't know if you're overpaying for the property or not. So a lawyer can't help you with that. Now, what happens if you submit an offer to us and we counteroffer back to you and we want an answer from you by 7 o'clock on Friday night? Well, your lawyer's gone home at 5 o'clock, you can't consult with a lawyer, and then you've got all weekend. So these offers can typically happen literally in hours. So if your lawyer's gone away for 3 days, well, that's too bad on you. You're not going to have a chance to tie up my seller's property for 3 days while we wait to see if you might respond to our counteroffer. So again, very, very high risk to you, and you need to understand those risks. And that's part of what that 13-page report is about from RECO. Now, there is the possibility that you could be in what's called multiple representation. So let's say you sign to work with me as a buyer, and you come to see my listing that I also have a contract with the seller. I'm the designated representative for both parties. That creates what's called multiple representation. And by the way, that is no different now than it was in the past under REBA. So that basically means that I'm representing both parties. First thing I have to do is make you both aware that, hey, got somebody here that might be interested in buying your property. They're also working with me. Are you okay with this? And both parties have to agree. I have to disclose, you have to agree. And by the way, in 33 years of doing this, I have never once had either party say, no, I don't want to look at an offer because it's coming from you. Sellers and buyers, they will work together to buy that property as long as they both know they're being treated fairly and that they're buying the property at fair market value. So in a multiple representation now, as before, what it basically means is that I must equally protect the interests of both the buyer and the seller, full disclosure of all factual information. So if the seller tells me, hey, I've got a basement that leaks every time it rains, I have to disclose that to you. That's the factual information, bit of information that's been shared with me, and I need to share that with you. And we must be instructed with written consent from the buyer and the seller when dealing with this. And typically what that means is that the written consent takes the form of an offer, an agreement of purchase and sale. You tell me the price, terms, and conditions you want in the offer. I provide that to the seller. The seller says, okay, let's counter back at this. So I just take that offer and give it to you and say, okay, the seller, this is what he wants to do. So that's it. Quickly wrap up. You need to sign this 13-page document. You're either a client or you're a self-represented party that comes with a lot of risks. Thank you for watching.